Good afternoon. My name is Christoph Baltzinger. I'm a forest ecologist working at INRAE in the Forest Ecosystems Research Unit. And I'm going to talk about ungulate-mediated seed dispersal and its consequences for plant distribution patterns. First of all, I want to introduce the plant life cycle, with adult plants that will produce fruits and then seeds that will be dispersed and released on the ground. They will germinate, produce seedlings, and then another adult plant that will close the loop and then produce new fruits and seeds. If we scale up to the plant community, we know that local plant communities are shaped from the regional species pool, and plants entering the local plant community have to go through three main filters. First one is the dispersal and the ability to reach a given environment. Can be done by endo or episocary by ungulates, for instance. Then you have the environmental filter, which corresponds to the abiotic condition at the releasing site. And this can also be modified by ungulate through soil disturbance or even nutrient deposition. And finally, you have the biotic context with interaction between plants, interaction mediated by selective herbivory, secondary dispersal by dung beetles, predation of seeds by rodents, or mushrooms developing on the fecal matter, on the feces released by the ungulates. If we are interested in seed dispersal mediated by ungulates, we can use a forward approach where we will focus on each phase of the dispersal cycle, the emigration, diaspora charge, the transfer, and then the immigration or the germination, where the seed will be established. Or you can use a backward approach, and that's the one we are going to look about in that presentation. And so the aim is to look at adult plant distribution patterns and try to understand what determines that specific distribution pattern, looking at the distribution of mother plants some years ago. You can see with that model ungulate, the visent, that the ungulates will be active in the different filters leading to the local plant community with dispersal, as you can see seeds clinging to its fur, with the environmental filter, with the deposition of feces, and hoof prints, and also soil disturbed by sandbathing, and also different biotic interaction either through selective herbivory or dung beetles or other animals. So ungulates are involved in different dispersal mechanisms. You will have on the left side of the screen the internal dispersal mechanisms, and on the right side, the external dispersal mechanisms. First of all, you have the process of regurgitation. Ruminants will regurgitate some endocarps that cannot go through the full digestive system. But if the digestion is complete, then the seeds will be released within the feces. It could be secondary dispersed by dung beetles. Seeds can also be dispersed by epizoochory, and then they will be released within the home range of the animal when it scratches along trees or other elements of the landscape. Seeds can also be transferred from one animal to another one. And if none of them have been dispersed primarily, then they will fall on the ground, but could be secondary dispersed by clinging to the hooves of the ungulate and will be released later on. All of those seeds can enter the seed bank and can then re-emerge if the soil is disturbed. The distance covered by the seeds moved by ungulates will depend on the dispersal mechanisms and on specific traits of the plant and of the ungulate. In that specific meta-analysis, we looked at the trait that will favor dispersal either through endozoochory or fur epizoochory. For endozoochory, for instance, we showed that neutrophily and the fact that plant can survive long term in the seed bank will favor endozoochory. For fur epizoochory, we found similarly that neutrophilous plant would be dispersed preferentially by ungulates, but also that elongated seeds or seeds with appendages will be favored by epizoochory. For both mechanisms, plants from open habitats will be also preferred for dispersal. So how can we unveil plant distribution patterns? We can use vegetation successive resampling, exploring the spatial changes in the distribution of winners, that is, plant species increasing over time in frequency and spatial distribution. We can do it using permanent plots. A second approach will be to use correlation with plant distribution patterns and specific landscape features that affect the connectivity for animals, like ungulate paths or edges. And we can do that using aerial data, LIDAR, or direct field observations. Third approach used by American colleagues is landscape genetics, which can help detail colonization history of plants. And for instance, Grasti et al. In 2020 tried to understand how the genetic structure linked to dispersal was related to the network of paths of voles, small rodents. In Arcambarois, northeastern France, there is a network of permanent plots which were installed by Jean-François Picard in 1976 and resurveyed twice in 1981, 2006, so a period of 30 years. Among 227 plots sampled three times, we were able to identify 169 plant species with sufficient occurrence and divide them into three categories. Winners, 57 species increasing between successive surveys. Species that remained stable, unchanged, 85, half of the plants. And then losers, 27 species decreasing between successive surveys. And so we can wonder which traits are at play to distinguish those species categories or temporal trajectories. Are the traits favoring seed dispersal? Are the traits favoring temporal persistence? Or are the traits, for instance, reducing palatability and so vulnerability to ungulates? Among the winner species, we found few species with typical zoochorus syndromes like epizoochory or endozoochory. And that's the reason why we think that approaches based on traits are more reliable. When we looked at the species that are dispersed by endozoochory by ungulates, we found only 4% of them that were considered endozoochorous. If we look at the species that are dispersed by epizoochory, only 1/3 are considered epizoochorous species. So we think that dispersal syndromes are not reliable to predict zoochory first and long distance dispersal associated with large mammals. So in Arkambawa, we have seen a dramatic expansion of a given species, Synoglossum germanicum. In 2006, it was present over the North Forest. In 1981, it was present only on roughly 10 plots, with the biggest one could be the place where it was been initially introduced, and it wasn't present in 1976. So we were able to link the presence of that plant and its abundance in 2006 with an index of deer frequentation in 1981. And this is linked with three characteristics at least for that plant. First of all, it's a typical epizoochorous species with glochids. It's also a toxic plant with alkaloids, so it's not eaten by ungulates. And third, it's a plant that is favored by small-scale ground disturbance. And in the Flore Forestière from Rameau, you can even read that you will find that plant on bed sites. So for that given plant, we were able to estimate a rough 300 meters per year of migration over 30 years by dividing the point of supposed introduction to the distance to the most remote location in 2006. And this is in agreement with an estimation we obtained by modeling epizoochorous dispersal by red deer in Chambord with an average of 300 to 450 meters for dispersal. What remains unknown is how that dispersal occurs. Is that frequent average distance dispersal events? Or can we infer a mix of dispersal events, some of them at short distances and some of them rare but at long distance? So that is the question we want to deal with in the future with the dataset from Arkambawa, because we need to provide more evidence to the role of ungulate to long distance plant dispersal. This is critical to predict their effect on plant distribution patterns in the context of rapid and drastic changes. And for that, approaches presented could be applied with additional datasets and cooperation, for instance, with the Forestry Plot Network. So this is a real call for cooperation and discussion. With that, I thank you for your attention. I'm open to answer your questions. Thank you.